prelude as you are in prayer and reflection. Good morning, everyone. We are glad that you are here with us for this time of worship. Whether you be joining us virtually or in person, we're glad to have you with us this day. Have a few announcements to share with you as we start. Please notice the Wednesday night supper schedule. We lost a lot this past week because of lightning. Remember that bad storm we had Tuesday night? Well, this week, we're going to be back in full swing. You'll see the sessions that are going on, the Bible study that we have for this coming Sunday's scripture lesson for next Sunday. That'll be in the Media Center. So the other classes that we have will be in the Fahola class. But you also get to see what the menu is for this coming week, as well as the prices. You will see other announcements that are in our bulletin. Trinity Day School is in the middle of their fall fundraiser. I want to give you an announcement that our children's ministry today will not meet. Miss Christie had a family emergency that she needs to tend to, so we will not have our children's ministry this afternoon. Our listening sessions are information sessions about the direction we're taking and asking our church council to take. They will continue this coming Tuesday night at 6:30 in the Fellowship Hall, 6:30 till about 7:30, and then there will be another one next Sunday morning. There are two more sessions, one Tuesday and one next Sunday, and that will be in the Fellowship Hall as well, about 9:45 or 9:50. And now, my friend, Steve McCormick, he's got an announcement.
All right, this one's in the bulletin as well. Here to ask for your support again for the Kyle Ross Prison Ministry. Yesterday we had our fourth and next to final team meeting. We are hoping to have five tables this time. Last time we only had enough team members for three tables. Need your support in three different ways. First and most importantly, we need your prayers. And of course, that can start right away, but part of the reason this ministry is so effective is it's a prayer-driven ministry. And one of the things that we do is we ask our congregations to sign up for a prayer vigil where the team and residents are prayed for the whole time that we're in there. If you sign up, and these sheets are in the Sunday school classes and in the vestibule, your name will appear on a prayer wheel. And it really has a huge impact on these residents to see so many people praying around the clock for them, not knowing them personally, but knowing where they are. So if you would do that, I would appreciate it. Of course, your name doesn't have to be on here for you to pray. Second thing we need are cookies. We used to ask for homemade cookies, but right now, because of COVID, post-COVID, we're having to use store-bought cookies. So when you're in the grocery store this week, pick up some, I don't know, chocolate chip, my favorite nutty butter, Oreos. These guys inside are like me. They've never met a cookie they didn't like. So if you'll place those in the sanctuary, in the vestibule as you come in. And finally, we need your financial support. Checks can be made out to Kairos of South Carolina. it's become a little more expensive in that we can't prepare the food. We have to buy the food prepared, catered, in other words, that we feed the guys on the weekend. So that is an added expense. Checks can made out, Comoros of South Carolina, no gift is too small, and I've not seen one too large yet either. So again, appreciate your support. Thank you for your time.
It is in mission, it is in ministry, and now we are going to be in fellowship for a moment, and then it's our time for worship. I invite you now to stand and greet those around you in the name of the Lord.
Please remain standing and join me in the call to worship. Give praise to God.
Praise the Lord, for it is God who saves. It is God who forgives.
It is God who delivers.
Give thanks and praise to the Lord.
Thank you.
Let us confess our sins to God who forgives and saves. Gracious and loving God, you lived for us. We have not lived for you. You have forgiven us. We have not forgiven others. You have loved us. We have not loved ourselves, nor have we loved one another. Take pity on us. Forgive us, God. Help us to forgive. Help us to live for you. Help us to love through Christ our Lord. Amen. People of God, our sins are forgiven. God is merciful and gracious and is Lord of us all. Reconciled to the God who loves us, let us live and love through Christ our Lord.
May be seated. At this time, if I could have the children come and join me up front. How did you sleep last night?
Okay.
Just a little bit. Good. Okay, good. I'm glad. Well, today I have a question for you. Have you ever had to tell someone that you were sorry? Yeah? Yeah, raise your hand. Yep. Has anyone ever said sorry to you? When is a time that we might have to say sorry?
When we accidentally push someone, or when we bump into someone accidentally,
or something like that. Yeah, when we accidentally bump into somebody, maybe you said something that wasn't really nice to your mom or dad or your siblings. Maybe you didn't listen and you ignored your parents. You guys never ignore your parents, do you? No, never. Oh, okay. Yes. So, how many times do you think we should forgive people?
70 times 7.
Oh my goodness, where did you learn that?
In Sunday school.
In Sunday school, you were paying attention. That is right. So, Jesus tells us in the Bible that we should forgive people 77 times 7 times. That's a really, really big number, don't you think?
4,000
or something, we're just guessing. So, next time, whenever you have to tell someone that you're sorry, or maybe someone has to tell you that they're sorry, we should forgive them with the love in our heart. So, can we pray really quick? Okay. All right, let's bow our heads and pray. Say,
Dear Jesus,
thank you for giving me love, and thank you for giving me the ability to forgive. In your name we pray. Amen. All right, and then y'all are going to go with Miss Elizabeth in the back, okay? All right, enjoy. Thank you.
That anthem was requested by Steve Reynolds, and I think I see him smiling in the back because that was a beautiful
rendition of that anthem. Our gospel lesson continues in the 18th chapter of Matthew. We'll be reading verses 21 through 35 of chapter 18, and I invite you to stand, rise as you can in body or in spirit for the reading of God's word. Then Peter came and said to him, "Lord, if another member of the church sins against me, how often should I forgive? As many as seven times?" Jesus said to him, "Not seven times, but I tell you, 77 times. For this reason, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle accounts with his slaves. When he began the reckoning, one of who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him. And as he could not pay, the Lord ordered him to be sold together with his wife and children and all his possessions, and payment be made. So the slave fell on his knees before the Lord and said, 'Have patience with me, and I will pay you everything.' Out of pity for him, the Lord of that slave released him and forgave him the debt. But that same slave, as he went out, came upon one of his fellow slaves who owed him 100 denarii. And he seized the man by the throat and he said, 'Pay me what you owe.' Then his fellow slave fell down and pleaded with him, 'Have patience with me and I will pay you.' But he refused. Then he went and threw him into the prison until he would pay the debt. When his fellow slaves saw what had happened, they were greatly distressed. And they went and reported to their Lord all that had taken place. Then the Lord summoned him and said to him, 'You wicked slave, I forgave you all that debt because you pleaded with me. Should you not have mercy on your fellow slave as I had mercy on you?' And in anger, his Lord handed him over to be tortured until he would pay his entire debt. So my heavenly Father will also do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother or sister from your heart." God bless the reading, the hearing, and the understanding of this, the holy word of our Lord. You may be seated.
If you would bow your head, let us pray. Holy God, we pray that you open our minds to receive your wisdom and our hearts to hear the truth. In your name we pray. Amen. Continuing in the lectionary readings, the Gospel of Matthew, this week's passage is another parable. To recap, last week, Pastor Joseph preached about dealing with sin within the church. When there's a fault between two people, it is not to be aired to the entire congregation. That is not an excuse to go whisper behind their back, but rather, it is to be handled privately between the two parties involved. Following Jesus' teaching, Peter pulled Jesus aside, as he often has, and asked, "Lord, Jesus, how many times am I to forgive a brother or sister who sins against me? 7? No. Jesus responded to Peter, not 7, but 77 times 7. And as Philip reminded us, that's about 4,000 times. I'm glad he did the math for me. Jesus then launches into another parable. In this parable, Jesus compares the kingdom of heaven to a king who wished to settle his accounts with his slaves. The king goes so far as to forgive a slave that owed him 10,000 talents. Now, this is equal to about 60 million denarii, otherwise converted to 60 million days of work. How this slave had this much debt is a sermon for a different day and a financial advisor's worst nightmare. Despite knowing it would be impossible for this slave to ever fully repay him, the king took pity and forgave his debts. Now, the slave that was just forgiven so graciously set out amongst his fellow slaves, and he found one who owed him 100 denarii. Now, 100 denarii is approximately 4 months worth of wages, not 60 million days. When the slave pleaded and pleaded, just as the other one had just done, to be forgiven, he refused and threw his peer into jail until his debts were paid back to him. Now, how he expected him to pay his debts when he isn't working because he's in jail is once again another sermon for another day. Rightfully so, when the other slaves heard about this endeavor between the two of them, they reported it to the king. When the king found out about the incident, he said to him, "You wicked slave, I forgave you all that debt just because you pleaded with me. Should you not have mercy on your fellow slaves, one of your own peers, as I have had mercy on you?" He was then handed over to be tortured until his unpayable debt shall be paid. Jesus concludes this parable with, "So my heavenly Father will also do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother or sister from your heart." Unlike other parables Jesus told, the message in this one is relatively straightforward. Forgive those around you, even when their debts are unpayable. Now, I don't like to make assumptions in my life, and especially not make assumptions from behind the pulpit, but I feel it's safe to assume that every person listening right now has either forgiven someone or been forgiven by someone at some point in their life. Surprise! We are not perfect. Humans make mistakes. Sometimes those mistakes are bigger than others, and it takes more time and conversations before forgiveness is the resolution. But prayerfully, forgiveness will come. However, when all is said and done, the trespasses are put in the past, people move forward, there's still a question, the one who made the initial mistake may wrestle with. Have I forgiven myself? Why is it so hard to forgive ourselves? Someone who strives to succeed in all aspects of life sets high expectations for themselves. So when they fail to meet those self-appointed expectations, especially because of a mistake they had made, forgiveness of self is the last thing on their mind. They have completely and utterly let themselves down. Their debts replay over and over again in their head as they question their movements, filling their thoughts with negative self-doubt. Why, just why can't I be responsible one time? I knew better. Yeah, I did. But I made the choice to still do it. I will always be a failure. If I can't do this one simple task, how am I supposed to continue moving forward in advance to the more complex task that lay in front of me? These thoughts can apply to anything in life, work, school, sports, social interactions. The list goes on and on. When someone else is the one being forgiven, it's easy for us to rationalize their wrongdoings. Oh, they're just little, they didn't know better. Well, they didn't grow up around here. We're not from the same part of town, so no one taught them that that was wrong. They're still new to the job. They're still learning how we do things around here. However, when someone makes a mistake, they wrestle with the self-forgiveness because they knew it was wrong, but still decided to do it anyway. In the parable, Jesus tells us to forgive not only 7, but 77 times 7. We often hear the golden rule from Jesus' Sermon on the Mount earlier in Matthew. Treat others the way you would like to be treated. We may tell our children that, our friends, colleagues, maybe the random person in the grocery store just really needed to hear that. Although, it's important that we spin that message back towards yourself, and you treat yourself the way that you would want others to treat you. We want others to extend grace and forgive us of our debts. So it is so important that we forgive ourselves of those debts as well, especially when the other person has already forgiven us. And even more so when the other person has not. And even when the other person has not forgiven you, God has forgiven you. God's grace knows no bounds. There's no conditions to God's love. Forgiveness is a gift of grace. Forgiveness is redemption of God's ultimate, unconditional love. There is nothing in this world that someone could do that God would not forgive them. As long as they forgive others and themselves with truth and faithfulness in their heart. There is no debt unpayable because Jesus paid it all. Humans, we were not put on this earth to be the ultimate judge. God is the ultimate judge and sent Jesus to free us from our sins. Jesus went so far as to die for those sins. This is the ultimate form of God's forgiveness. As the famous hymn sings, Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. When we fill our hearts with forgiveness, we enter into this divine space, allowing ourselves to accept and feel the fullness of God's love. Forgiveness is filled with justice, love, peace. A forgiven heart is one that exudes joy rather than condemnation and anger. Forgiveness is transformative. By allowing ourselves to embrace God's forgiveness and forgive ourselves as well as others, we are then able to be better disciples for Christ as our hearts are filled with the Holy Spirit. Now, after all, isn't that the biggest thing about being a Christian? Being a disciple of Christ, sharing that light in the world and listening to his great commission that he once gave to his disciples, and then once they passed on, and now we are the ones that are called to live out this calling. When we allow ourselves to believe and know in our hearts, I am forgiven. Don't just say it, mean it. Because that is the truth. In the name of God, who so graciously forgives and calls us to forgive. Amen. If you would now please stand and turn to page 881 in your hymnal for the affirmation of faith. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. Third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From this come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life. Amen. And now, if you would turn to your bulletin, so we can affirm who and what we are as Trinity United Methodist Church. What is Trinity's vision or mission?
Make disciples of Jesus Christ.
What is Trinity's vision? Why are we about the work to fulfill our mission and vision? Amen.
Thank you. You may be seated.
We had a bad thunderstorm Thursday night. Knocked power out for many people. We had some problems here at Trinity in the building. But it was nothing. Nothing compared to what the people of Morocco are going through and Libya are going through. Earthquakes and floods. One of the things of the United Methodist Church is that we are in mission in places where there is hurt and need. And already United Methodist missionaries, United Methodist relief is on the way to those places. We pray for those of Libya and Morocco. We pray for those of Guatemala. Our mission trip is long over, and we're already looking towards the next one. But we are mindful of what is going on in Guatemala, the poverty that is there. We're mindful of the hurt, the loss, the grief within our own fellowship. So my friends, as Gray McCleary comes to offer the morning prayer, we will hear this instrumental special. As we reflect and as we pray on the concerns and the joys of our hearts, let us go to the Lord for a few quiet moments.
Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, thank you for forgiving us endlessly. Grant us the strength to forgive others, releasing any bitterness or resentment. May the transformative power of forgiveness bring healing and reconciliation in our relationships. Cleanse us from all unrighteousness and restore a right spirit within us. Give us a grace-filled heart towards those who have sinned against us, and make us a gracious forgiver of repeat offenders. Like a father showing compassion to your children, you never run short of patience and love, and we seek your intervention to lead us to the light and to hear your voice in our daily lives. Dear Lord, we offer you our praise. You are the King of mercy and grace. You have forgiven us more than we can ever repay. Help us to forgive others as you have forgiven us. Teach us to be compassionate and generous and to love one another as you love us. Let us learn to let go, to be free and happy, and to ask forgiveness from you, our merciful Father. In your precious name we pray. Amen.
Children's sermon can teach you a lot of things. We learned about forgiveness and that we all have done it, but did you hear what happened when Rachel asked the question? And one of the children who was in Sunday school this morning knew the answer. That's because our children's Sunday school class bases their lesson each week on the scripture lesson that we have on Sunday morning. Our Sunday school teachers do a wonderful job, not just at the children's level, but our youth, our adults, their time for fellowship, time to drink a little coffee, a time to talk about the game last night or not. Our Sunday school teachers prepare just as surely as preachers do. And we're thankful for those teachers who step up and make a difference in our time of education, time of fellowship, our time of being and learning about what it means to be Christian. At this time, will our ushers please come forward for the dedication of our tithes and offerings. I invite you now to pray with me the prayer of thanksgiving that is found in the bulletin. Oh God, we give you thank you for these gifts. Multiply them and enable the work of love and the righteousness of your kingdom in the world. We thank and praise you. Amen. And we pray now, O Lord, as your Son taught, when we pray together, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us of our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Our hymn is 390, Forgive Our Sins as We Forgive. As the forgiven and reconciled people of God, go in the world and forgive. Forgive as Christ has forgiven you. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.